Hello, I'm Daniela Elena. In episode 55 of Historical Paranormal, we'll explore the notorious secret society and college fraternity of former U.S. presidents, Skull and Bones. At Yale University, there is a secret society that has been around for over four decades known as the Order of the Skull and Bones, known for its East Coast elitism. In 1925, author F. Scott Fitzgerald had two of his main WASPy characters in The Great Gatsby belonging to it. Later in the television series Batman, Bruce Wayne's grandfather wears a Yale sweater in his portrait and was said to have founded Skull and Bones. One of Skull and Bones' most infamous artifacts is the stolen skull of Apache warrior Geronimo, who died in 1909 after two decades as a prisoner of war at Fort Sill, Oklahoma. Skull and Bones owns Deer Island in St. Lawrence River in Alexandria, New York. The society uses it for get-togethers, and every new member visits it. Though servants once served catered meals in elegant cottages in the island, little is left of the old buildings. The 40-acre retreat had dense undergrowth, stone ruins, and a small lodge. One bonesman described it as a beautiful dump. Alfonso Taft, founder of the political dynasty and father of President William Taft, co-founded Skull and Bones in 1832 with William Huntington Russell, 1856. Incorporated the Russell Trust as the business arm of the society. Both President George H.W. and George W. Bush belonged to the Bones. So did Secretary of State John Kerry, the younger Bush's opponent in the 2004 presidential election. Bush wrote in his autobiography, "In my senior year, I joined Skull and Bones, a secret society. So secret, I can't say anything more." Reporter once asked Kerry what it meant that two bonesmen to run against each other for president. He replied, "Not much, because it's a secret." Of Yale's 41 secret societies, Bones is only the fifth richest with 4,129,936 in assets in 2015, according to the Business Insider. Bonesman William F. Buckley led a group that sued to block the admission of women to Skull and Bones in 1991. Though black men were admitted since 1965, the Russell Trust adamantly opposed. When the class of 91 tapped seven women for the 92 class, the Russell Trust changed the locks on the tomb. Members voted by mail, 368 to 320, to allow women. But then Buckley and his group got a temporary restraining order against the move. The lawsuit eventually fizzled out, and the first woman joined in 1992. 9 years after Geronimo's death, Skull and Bones members were stationed at the army outpost and dug up the warrior's grave and stole his skull, as well as some bones and other personal relics. They then took the remains to New Haven, Connecticut, at the Society's clubhouse, the Skull and Bones tomb. Prescott Bush, father of George H.W., and grandfather of George W. Bush, was among the grave robbers. All members swear an oath never to reveal what goes on inside the tomb, a sandstone-like structure in a crypt. The number 322 appears on the society's insignia. It is said to refer to 322 BC, when Athens lost the Lamian War and had to dissolve its democracy. A new plutocratic government allowed only wealthy Athenians to remain citizens. Author Mark Wortman says when he was at Yale Sterling Library researching the Millionaires Unit, his book about young men from the university who flew during World War I, he stumbled on a letter that seemed to confirm the rumor. Former U.S. Attorney General Ramsey Clark, who represents the Geronimo family, says the Geronimo made it very clear, even before his surrender, that he wanted to be in the Apache lands of southwestern New Mexico. When he met with Teddy Roosevelt, for instance, in March of 1905, his request was he and the other Chiricahua Apaches who were prisoners of war be permitted to return to the headwaters of Gila River, adding that if he couldn't return in his lifetime, that he wanted to be buried there, says Clark. But Susan Schoen Harjo, president of the Morning Star Institute, a Native rights organization, says it might not be possible to return Geronimo's remains. 20 years ago, an Apache tribal chairwoman told Harjo that the Geronimo's body had already been moved from Oklahoma to New Mexico. Even if the lawsuit turns up a skull in Connecticut, then you have to question of who. Whose head is it? Said Harjo. We may never know the truth about Geronimo's remains, says Jeff Hauser, chairman of the Fort Steele Apache tribe. Hauser is uncomfortable with the lawsuit that would prefer not to disturb Native human remains. He also disputes the idea that Apaches are traditionally buried in their homeland. Unlike what was stated in the complaint, Apaches do not like to descend to remains, and there is no tradition of burying them in their birthplace. Apaches were nomadic people, says Homer. When somebody is buried, we traditionally do not revisit the grave. We don't make a big deal of it. And there's further complication. Alexander Robbins, author of Secrets of the Tomb, Skull and Bones, the Ivy League, and the Hidden Paths of Power, says that even if Bonesmen displayed Geronimo's skull in the tomb at one time, it's not likely there now. There, at one time, approximately 800 living members of this organization across the world. So any of them could have put the skull anywhere by now, and it's never going to surface, says Robbins. In an email, Yale's university spokesman Tom Conroy wrote, Yale does not possess Geronimo's remains. Yale does not own the Skull and Bone building or the property it's on, nor does Yale have access to the property or the building. Efforts to reach members of Skull and Bones for comment were met with silence. Skull and Bones continues to be shrouded in mystery and conspiracy theories, even tying them to the World War. Thank you for tuning in. Until next time.